Good afternoon, all of you. I hope you are doing well. And today we have with us Dr. K. Chandran. Sir is head ICR Sugar and Breeding Institute Research Center at Kanpur. And the topic of deliberation today, which sir is going to deliberate on, is sugarcane genetic resource conservation and utilization. Sir, you are audible as well as visible. Your presentation is also visible. Please start, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, please, sir.
Respected course director Dr. Rehabakrupa and course coordinator Dr. Murali and fellow colleagues from NSDL and dear participants. Today in the afternoon, we will be discussing about the sugarcane genetic resources with a special reference to the conservation and utilization. Genetic resources, I need not much explain about the importance of it, but for a definition, we can say that any genetic material of actual and potential value for the crop improvement program is termed as genetic resources. With respect to sugarcane, you talk about the Saccharum genus. We have around six species: Saccharum officinarum, Saccharum robustum, Saccharum medule, Saccharum sinense, Saccharum barberi, and Saccharum spontaneum as the primary genetic resources for the crop improvement program. And other genera from the Saccharum complex, especially the Erianthus, Sclerostachia, Naranga, and Miscanthus. So as the widely related genus like sorghum, Sia, Imbreta, and bamboos also forms the genetic resources. However, for the collection and conservation purpose, we will be mostly on the different species of Saccharum and the genera from the Saccharum complex. Now, coming to the center of origin and the diversity of Saccharum officinarum, we know that it is Saccharum officinarum is originated in Melanesia region, where the it consists of the islands of Fiji, Vanuatu, Solomon Islands, Papua New Guinea, New Caledonia, and parts of Indonesia. Similarly, Saccharum robustum also originated in Papua New Guinea, and Saccharum edule also originated in the same region. The early migration of noble canes starting from New Guinea to other parts of the world, you can classify actually Hatzweiger and Brandis in 1958 classified this into three pathways for the migration of noble canes from the New Guinea. The first pathways you can see here from the New Guinea, where the red mark are shown, through a double line it is passing towards east to the Solomon Islands and then to New Hebrides is the first path of migration way back in 8000 BC. And the second path of migration again towards east from New Hebrides to New Caledonia and Fiji Islands. And from towards west, it goes through Indonesia, then Indochina, Burma, and towards India during the around 6000 BC. And the third path of migration we can see in the map as a dotted lines. You can from here Amboina to Carolina Islands and Mariana Islands, and again from Fiji to Tonga, Samoa Islands, Phoenix Islands, and to Hawaii, and again from to Tahiti and Marquesas Islands. This is actually the primary migration of the noble canes. From where it is migrated to different parts as listed, from there it has in progressed with the local wild flora and further diversified. Excuse me for there is some problem with the presentation slides. We'll continue short while. Yeah, now coming back to the Saccharum officinarum, we have found that a lot of variation in the species. Within the species, we have around 757 different types of Saccharum officinarum in our collection. The major variation is with respect to the morphological characters, sugar content, and the cane thickness, and as well as for other genetic characters, just like chromosome numbers. Here we call Saccharum officinarum the typical one with the chromosome number 2N is equal to 80, and atypical forms, which is other than the 2N 80, maybe either 70 less or the greater than 80, which are under cultivations, or it may possibly these are all the natural hybrid origin. Now coming to the botanical origin, it is a lot of speculations and so many hypotheses were there. Some of the most important hypotheses we'll discuss here. The first one is Grassel in 1974. He postulated that Saccharum robustum in the ancestry of Saccharum officinarum, and even involvement of Erianthus maximus. And Erianthus maximus in turn is a hybrid origin. And another hypothesis was the Daniel and Roach proposed in 1987, the integration between Saccharum spontaneum, Erianthus serotinaceus, and Miscanthus sinensis. And the intermediate product is, they termed it as Saccharum robustum. And for robustum, we know that there are three types, cytotypes mainly, the 2N is equal to 60 and the 2N80 type, and the 2N is greater than 114. Out of which the 2N60 types are having the red flush, and it is distributed in the river bank of the Sepi. And most likely from this population, the red flush group of Saccharum robustum on further integration with the other species of other grasses of the in the adjoining areas, and developed into Saccharum officinarum. The officinarium is supported by the proof that Saccharum officinarium clones, which is moved to the Pacific Islands in the early period, especially to Hawaii, had the pink to red flush, similar to that of Saccharum robustum, the red flush type. Now we can see the variation of red flush, flush color to in Saccharum robustum. Here you can see the red flush type of Saccharum robustum, and side by side it is a normal flush color in the other group of Saccharum robustum. And in the Saccharum officinarum, we have a lot of variation from the creamy white to light green, then light pink color, then again greenish color and pink color, and almost brown color in the flesh. So probably this flesh color leads to a way of thinking that this might have originated from the Saccharum robustum with red flesh with further integration with other species. Now, if you the phylogeny of Saccharum officinarum was compiled by Daniel et al. In 1989, showing the two biparental crosses, one with Saccharum spontaneum into Erianthus serotinaceus, which resulted in the Kalimantan type of Saccharum robustum, and the Erianthus serotinaceus into Miscanthus, the red leafed Miscanthus, which resulted in the Saccharum robustum with red leaves. And from this, Saccharum red flush to Saccharum robustum might have evolved, and integration is 2N is equal to 60, and further integration with other species might have developed into 2N80 types. And it is again explained that some of the seed clones are available even with 2N is equal to 70, maybe an intermediate forms after 2N60 to 80 type. And this is one of the clone which is having 2N70 is having sweeter canes like NG28218. And ultimately the population might have lost further chromosome and reached red flush type again. And with respect to the center of origin of other species, the other cultivated species, Saccharum barberi, we know that it is originated in India as an Indo-Pacific origin, probably with the Saccharum officinarum into spontaneum. And the Saccharum sinensis, it is developed at Canton in China as an Indo-Pacific origin, Saccharum officinarum into Miscanthus being proposed. And other hypotheses related to the origin of Saccharum barberi and sinensis, Roach and Daniel listed are all groups originated independently from the indigenous wild forms of Saccharum in China, Saccharum sinensis, and India, Saccharum barberi. And Saccharum barberi arose from the integration of Saccharum officinarum with the Saccharum spontaneum in India. And Saccharum sinensis is a product of Saccharum officinarum into Miscanthus saccharifloris integration in China. And another with the Saccharum sinensis and Saccharum barberi groups are single chance hybridization. That first one or two progenies were developed. From there, further by somatic mutation, diversity of forms are observed under this species. And Saccharum sinensis and barberi arose through integration between Erianthus and section Ripidium and Sclerostachia and Miscanthus at varying levels of ploidy. This was another view regarding the origin of Saccharum sinensis. Now, regarding to Saccharum sinensis, Professor Zhou from China proposed another hypothesis that Saccharum sinensis arose independently in China. It originated from Saccharum officinarum of New Guinean origin with integration with the local wild grasses. And linguistic evidence also support that it's a Austronesian origin of it in Taiwan and South China around 4000 BC. Now the Saccharum barberi, the diversity has been classified into five subgroups. Mungo is the group with cytotypes ranging from 81 to 83 chromosomes to a number, and Nargori with 105 to 124. Sarita having two subgroups, Kartha subgroup with 91 and 92 chromosome number, and Kalkia subgroup with 106 and 111. Sannavel group having two subgroup again, Daulu and Daulu subgroup and Mojara subgroup. Daulu having chromosome numbers ranging between 82 and 83, and Mojara in 106 to 121. And the Panasahi group, which is identified by Barber, is later treated as Saccharum sinensis, and the chromosome number varies here from 111 to 120. And the another wild species which is widely utilized in the crop improvement of sugarcane, it is widely distributed throughout Asia and Africa, extending from Japan and Indonesia, New Guinea through Indian subcontinent to Mediterranean and Africa. A lot of diversity is available. It is divided into three subspecies: Indicum, Egyptiacum, and Luzonicum. And under Indicum subspecies, we have varieties like Genuinum with 2N40 to 80, Gensifolium with curled leaves or weird leaves, 2N is equal to 40, and Roxburghii with very narrow leaves, 2N9 ranging from 96 to 112. And in the Egyptiacum subgroup, we have varieties like Egyptiacum, 2N is equal to 112, and Claga, which is originated in Java, is 2N112, and Nepalensis type. And under Luzonicum, it is geographical grouping has been done further. It is which is distributed in the eastern part, China, Japan, and Indonesia, where 2N is ranging from 18 to 112. And the central type is mainly in India. It is distributed 2N is equal to 40 to 80. And the west countries, we have 2N 104 to 128. And Harlan and DeWitt in 1971 classified the gene pool for the gene pool of cultivated crops into primary gene pool, secondary gene pool, and tertiary gene pool. Can we discuss this primary gene pool concept in sugarcane? Well, we say that primary gene pool is classified as it is equivalent to the biological species that cross very easily, and all the other attributes like hybrids are generally fertile with a good chromosome pairing. Gene segregation is approximately normal, and the gene transfer is generally simple. Here, all the species in Saccharum, all the species belong of the Saccharum is classified under primary gene pool. And not only all the species, but the genus coming under the Saccharum complex is also freely hybridizable, and all the other traits are acceptable for it. And these are also classified under the primary gene pool of Saccharum. In primary gene pool, we have the collection of Saccharum officinarum. We already discussed the origin is in New Guinea and Indonesian archipelago. Around 757 clones under this, and most of them are with 2N80 type, the typical Saccharum officinarum. And many atypical forms, which are natural hybrids, are available in the group. And the typical Saccharum officinarum is characterized by the thick grains, very juicy, and soft rind, high sugar content. And most of the collections what we have mainly from the New Guinea, where the center of origin, and Indonesia, where the distribution is there. Fiji and Mauritius and Hawaii, and we also have a collection which is collected from India, well, mostly from the northeastern part of the country, where Chuitita were migrated much earlier in the migration path. And when we see these types of Saccharium officinarium, what is available in our collection, you can see that 2N70, we have one of the examples we have given in the right side, it is 51NG65. And 2N74 to 76, this is a Fiji B is coming under that. And 78 to 80 with Manila and 57NG287. And 80 chromosome types are most of them, 409 clones belongs to the typical Saccharium officinarium. And between 80 and 81, we have 57NG34. Chromosome number 80 to 82, we have 51NG133. Similarly, we also have different general cytotypes like 80 to 84, 85, 90, 92 plus 9 fragments, 92 to 99, 98, 99 to 102, going up to 120 in 28NG287. These are the cytotypes, a lot of respect to the chromosome available in the Saccharium officinarium collection. And Haeckel in 1889 divided Saccharium officinarium into three groups based on the cane characteristics. Here the first group we classified as genium, where the yellow and the green sugar cane canes are considered. This is a typical yellow canes, and we have a typical green. And within genium, it is again subdivided into commune, which is a normal type, and with brevipedicillatum, where the florets have spiculate has smaller pedicels. And the second group is the violaceum type of Saccharium officinarium. Here the leaf color is purple in the early stage, and when it matures, it is slowly acquire the more chlorophyll pigment and the color changes to green. And here the rind color is very dark, purple dark in color. And Grassel in 1967 attributed this trait probably because of introduction from miscarriage genotype. And the third type is Lilaceum, where a lot of striped canes are classified under this group. Yellow green stalks with striped with red. You can see one of the example of striped canes. This is also peculiar in that it is 51NG151. You might have seen in a lot of the textbooks cover page. This having a peculiar internode size, internode shape, and internode alignment, and the tumescent type internodes with yellowish green with purple stripes on it. And this is the overall diversity with respect to the rind color. I have given only some few canes, I have photographed it. This is, you can see almost all the color variation from a green to a yellow to the dark purple and the purple black color with a lot of striped canes in between. These are all the striped canes. It is both yellow, yellowish green and in background with the purple stripes, as well as green with yellow stripes on the canes like this one. And we have that 51NG131, that tumescent canes. And now coming to Saccharium robustum, the wild species, of one of the wild species of Saccharium. It is also originated in South Pacific Islands, Papua New Guinea. They are very tall cranes. You can see the height of the canes achieved within 1 year. And it is almost a perennial kind of growth habit is there for these canes. And it is very low in juice, and the sucrose is also very low. We have around 128 Saccharium robustum collection. It is including all the around 9 red fluster types as well as the normal type. And Saccharium robustum is classified into three groups mainly on cytotypes. The 2N60 types, you have three different types, red flushed one, Gibbosella and Wau Bulolo. And 2N80 type, this Quarter Mosby and Goroka type. And 2N greater than 114 type, they are giant fencing clones, which is used by the Aborigine of New Guinea for fencing gardens. And among that, we have 9 refreshed clones. We have shown, I have shown this longitudinal section of a cane. We can see that front flush character, and inside that is a pithy region where whiteness is there. And another species, it can be told that it is cultivated species, with Saccharium medulla. It is It is almost similar to Saccharina robustum in the morphological features, but we have around 17 clones of Saccharina medule. The two end ranging from 60, 70, and 80, and of course some of the aneuploids as well. You can see the inflorescence where we can call it as a cob, just like a maize cob. And when you open it, you will find the edible portion like this, centered around the central axis. And the inflorescence is edible, and also it is a delicacy in the Pacific Islands. And here also there are two types of Saccharina medule. It is proposed that the New Guinean types are originated from Saccharina robustum into Miscanthus hybridization by natural hybridization. And the Fijian type also is originated as a result of Saccharina officinarum into Miscanthus process. You can see the variation for even with respect to the color of the inflorescence, the edible part. Here it is somewhat creamy yellow color, and it is almost yellow color. And this length of inflorescence goes almost to 30 centimeter, and this is the edible portion we removed from the central axis. And the weight comes somewhere around 40 to 50 grams only, which is very small if you compare to any other edible crop like cauliflower or baby corn or other crops. And the other cultivated species, Saccharum barberi, we know that it is originated in the North India by the integration of Saccharum officinarum into other wild grasses. They are very thin and short canes. Around 42 clones we have in this collection. The 2N is ranging from 82, this is Agolis 7 genotype, and to 124 in Sararu. Some of the clones are resistant to smut, and there is one clone which is consistently giving red rot resistance to red rot reaction. This is Cavalli 14G, and almost 11 clones are moderately resistant to red rot. And it is also described that in general they are tolerant to drought and winter conditions. This is the other cultivated species, Saccharum sinensis. It is originated in China, and diversity also in China. We have around 30 collection of this species, and they are characterized compared to Saccharum barberi. They are looking almost similar in the morphology, but having broader leaves, bobbin-shaped internodes, and the 2N ranging from 112 to 120. Almost three clones were resistant to smut, and one clones were resistant to red rot. It's called Ikri, and three moderately resistant to red rot are also available: the Kalkia, Kaki, and Reha in this population. This is some of the characters of Saccharinus related with respect to cane thickness. You can see how narrow it is, 0.121 to 1.7 centimeter only. And single cane weight, you can see 0.13 kg to 0.76 kg. And cane length from 58 centimeter to 235 centimeter, as well as the sucrose is a very narrow range from 3.93 to 17.8%. The other most important wild species of Saccharum is Saccharum spontaneum, which is attributed, the origin is attributed to the Indian conditions. And it is widely distributed in India, Asia, and African countries. At Kannur Center, we have around 384 clones. The remaining clones, which are collected after 1984, are maintained at Coimbatore. And the 2N is ranging from 40 to 128. There is a high level of resistance for red rot, as well as waterlogging and drought condition is available with this genotype. And it is widely being utilized for the development of commercial canes. And among the related genera, we have Erianthus. Erianthus are seven species, out of which almost six species are available in our collection. Erianthus arundinaceus, having the 2N type ranging from 30, 40, and 60 type. And Erianthus procerus 2N is equal to 40 type, Erianthus ravenae 2N is equal to 20, Erianthus elephantinus 2N is equal to 20, Erianthus balanae 20 type, 30, 40, and 60 cytotypes, and Erianthus vastae 2N is equal to 20, and Erianthus canaceroe 2N is equal to 60. Here we can see that most of them are good sources of resistant to red rot. This is a field of Erianthus arundinaceus. And here we have evaluated this against the arundinaceous for some of the agronomical and quality traits. Here the cane length, you can see it is ranging from 263 centimeter to 471 centimeter. Single cane weight, which is very low because very low juice content in that, 0.24 to 0.7 kg only. And extraction percentage, you can see it is very low, only 12.7% is the mean extraction percentage. And BRICS percentage also low, so ranging from 6 to 12. So as the sucrose percentage, 0.6 to 6 percentage only. And among the other related genera, Spirostachya is another group where we have 2 and 3 is equal to 30 and 34. We have three species. We have Sclerostachya fusca, Sclerostachya milroi, and Sclerostachya ridley. These are closely related to Naringa porphyrocoma for even for morphology, but for the absence of pedicel in the spikelet of Naringa in one of the pairs, and it has bearded board. Naringa is having the bearded node and adding a peculiar bronze colored inflorescence. Naringa also 2N is equal to 30 type, two species, Naringa phalax and Naringa porphyrocoma. And another widely utilized genus for the crop improvement of sugarcane is Miscanthus, where 2N is equal to 38 and 40 types are there. Around 12 species has been reported under the Miscanthus. Section Diandra, the diversity is available in India. We have four species coming under section Diandra: Miscanthus nepalensis, Miscanthus nodipes, Miscanthus oligostachys, and Miscanthus intermedius. And we do have two accession of Miscanthus in the gene bank belongs to Miscanthus. And coming to the, apart from the species collection, we do have maintained there in Indian hybrids which are developed before 1984. We have around 1031 clones, including cocaines as well as the station specific varieties. Cocaines developed with some bio clones, COK clones, and COS. And Mandia clones and IC urine canal clones. And these are the primary sources for breeding program for different characters. And if at all, when any epidemic forms or new pest or diseases comes, these are the primary material we utilize for the screening of the available gene pool. And exotic hybrids, so these are the hybrids which are developed for commercially released varieties as well as the historical hybrids from other countries. We have around 614 clones representing 17 sugarcane growing countries. Major collections from the CP Canal Point, we have 90 clones, and Barbados, we have 71 clones, Puerto Rico, we have 57 clones, and Fiji, we have 52 clones, Hawaii, we have 32 clones. And the POJCTS clones from Indonesia, we have 32. And among these clones, after our evaluation, we found that CP and SP clones found to grow better in the tropical condition prevailing in our state. And in the secondary gene pool, it is characterized by all the species. Of course, it will be crossable with the crop. And gene transfer is possible, but with difficulty. Hybrids tend to be weak and sterile sometimes. And the chromosome pairs poorly or sometimes not at all. And recovery of desired types may require some intervention for retrieving it. And Imbrata and Miscanthidium is falling in the secondary gene fold with respect to sugarcane. And this is the photograph of Imbrata cylindrica and Miscanthidium violaceum. And in the tertiary gene pool, here also the species can be crossed with the crop, but hybrids tend to be mostly anomalous, lethal, or sometimes completely sterile. And gene transfer is either not possible with the conventional method of hybridization, or extreme radical measures are required to take it. And in this sorghum and CIA is falling in the tertiary gene pool. And now coming to the conservation aspect, we know that what is the importance of conservation. Why to conserve? It is the raw material for improving production and the productivity of a crop. It acts as an insurance against the pests and diseases. For improving the quality, we need the genetic resources. And it harbors the most of having the sources of resistance to tolerance or tolerance to biotic stresses. And in general, it maintains the ecological balance. And there are different strategies for different crops adopt for conservation. There are three types of conservation: ecosystem level conservation, mainly for in situ conservation, and species level, it is mainly coming under the ex situ conservation mode, and the gene level at DNA conservation mode. Of course, the strategy differ with the crop, and none of the method can replace all the three type of conservation methods may be required if possible. And these are the conservation options. For in-situ conservation, we can conserve the material in biosphere reserve, botanical garden, sacred grove, and one form conservation. But with respect to sugarcane, if you talk about only the wild species, we will find in the biosphere reserves and botanical garden and sacred grove have not much role to play in the sugarcane germ blossom conservation. And in ex-situ conservation, if it is for an orthodox seeds, we have a cold storage module for preservation, for medium term storage with 10 degree centigrade and long term storage with minus 20 degree centigrade. Here the problem is that with the sugarcane is that it is a vegetatively propagated crop. Most of the clone doesn't produce flower, or even if they flower, it may not produce seeds by selfing. And in that, one of the wild species, a kind of spontaneum, some of the studies show that at minus 20 degree centigrade, it can be conserved for 5 years with 10% reduction of the viability of the seeds. And moreover, Saccharum spontaneum produce true seeds without much complication by selfing. But again, in many of the Saccharum spontaneum also does not flower under the tropical condition. And this has to be optimized to produce flowering, then only we'll be able to conserve it in the form of the seeds. And another method of ex situ conservation is cryoconservation. If it is a small seed, we can conserve under the small containers, liquid nitrogen containers. And of course, recalcitrant seeds also, this method of conservation is adopted. Again, sugarcane has a reservation of cryoconservation of seeds because we don't get true seeds in most of the clones. And there is some study shows that 3 to 4 weeks of conservation in at minus 10 degree centigrade. The polar conservation, the partial genomic conservation, the cryopreservation is yet to be exploited in the sugarcane. And coming to the in vitro conservation, this is one of the alternative methods we follow at our gene bank, where we utilize the slow growth preservation and the normal mode of in vitro cryopreservation, where the plants are which are difficult to grow under the field condition, we take to the tissue culture and culture it and multiply there and maintain, and we will take back to the field when it attain the proper growth. And here cryopreservation also is another option with desiccation and vitrification and encapsulation. This is also a very infant stage in the sugarcane germ blossom conservation. And finally, the DNA gene bank. It is also one of the feasible options. We know that DNA is the most stable biomolecule on Earth. But only little information on the long-term stability of the scattered DNA is available under the frozen conditions. But theoretically, if you say that it can conserve any longer under the cryopreservation. And it is reported that replicated DNA sample can be maintained at minus 20 degrees centigrade for a short and mid-term storage, and at minus 70 degrees centigrade or in liquid nitrogen for a much longer period. But one of the disadvantages with the DNA is that it cannot be immediately brought back to the original condition where it can be utilized immediately. That is one of the major disadvantages of this DNA conservation. And in sugarcane, we can we visualize field gene bank is a major method of conservation, complemented by seed conservation by in Saccharum spontaneum, and in vitro conservation with limited with growth retardants or under reducing the temperature condition, or cryopreservation once they have a stable method, proper method is standardized for cryopreservation, either as a shoot tip or the pollen grains as a partial genome. And of course, the DNA can also play some role in the conservation of sugarcane germ blossom. And coming to the conservation status, at present, we have at Kannur Center, we have 373 accessions, so mainly belongs to Saccharum officinarum, 757 clones. Saccharum robustum and edul 145 clones, Saccharum barberi 42, Saccharum sinensis 30, Saccharum spontaneum 384, and the foreign hybrid 640 accessions, and Indian hybrids 1031, And AI clones, these are a product of Indo-American collaborative program where the commercial hybrid of USA has been crossed with the Saccharum spontaneum and some of the promising clone seedlings were selected from that. We have around 130 clones for their different tribes, including resistance. And it is very, all the clones were flowering type, so this can be easily utilized in the crop improvement program. And elite genera and others, we are 240, mainly Arianthus species, and Naringa and Sclerosacea, and one or two clones of Miscanthus. And in the National Active Gene Bank, we have 240 collection at Coimbatore, and elite genera around 493 at Coimbatore, and Indian hybrid 1330, and 452, and Saccharum spontaneum 1620 collection. It also duplicates some of the collections available at the control center. And once you have the ample of collection with us, the next step of utilization is the characterization. It has to be extensively and exhaustively should have been characterized. And mainly all the morphological characters, of course, we'll be looking for immediately after collection. Then subsequently for anatomical, for any of the stress-related aspects or biotic or abiotic stresses, and cytological, most of the clones were karyotypes was identified, and the molecular characterization, DNA fingerprinting, and yield and quality assessment, stress resistant, as and other agronomical characters. And another concept of efficient utilization of the genetic resources are the core and mini core set. When we have a large number of collections, it is better to have a core set for easy and quick screening for different stress or biotic stress or abiotic stresses. Frankel in 1984 defined the core set as a limited set of accession representing with a minimum of repetitiveness and the genetic diversity of a cross species and its wild relatives. And when coming to the mini core, when you are even a core set is not very easy to handle. Suppose if you have a collection more than 15 or 20,000, and if a 10% comes around 1,000 to 2,000 accession. In such cases, a mini core system, core system is proposed, where it has been further brought down to the 10% level from the core collection, so that it can be easily screened for the various traits and for other molecular as well as gene identifications. And with respect to Saccharum sugarcane, we have a core set of Saccharum officinarum developed by Balakrishnan et al. In 2000, and a core set of Saccharum spontaneum developed by Amalraj et al. In 2006. And once we have enough characterization, the next part is you have to document properly for retrieving the information. We have developed around 8 catalogs have been published so far since 1983. The first one was for Saccharum spontaneum by Kandasamy et al. And Barberry, Sinensis, Robustum, and Edule in 1985 by Ramana Rao et al. And for Saccharum officinarum in 1991 by Stevie Srinivasan et al. And co-varieties for yield and quality published in 1995 by Nair et al. And sugarcane database of exotic hybrids, yield and quality data in 1997. And catalog on Arianthus species in 2001 by Trivi Srinivasan et al. And catalog on genetic resource of Saccharum spontaneum by Trivi Srinivasan in the same year. And catalog of sugarcane genetic resource of Indian hybrids by Dr. Balasundaram et al. In 2005. And all these catalogs are available with the library of Sugarcane Breeding Institute. And the second part, most recently, we have developed a digital database of exotic hybrids. This includes all the passport data as well as characterization data and the photographs of three prominent regions, the crown region and cane, full cane, as well as the nodal region. Where with this we can easily distinguish or you can identify the species, and is for even for conservation also it is very much useful. And we have a digital database of Saccharum robustum. Recently it has come out in 2020, and we have digital database of Saccharin sinensis and Saccharin barberi, and the database of Saccharin minorum and Saccharin spontaneum is in the preparation. And now coming to the utilization part, we all know that we have a very long history of crop improvement, starting since 1888. Salt beetle from Java and simultaneously Bowell and Harrison from Barbados. Once they rediscovered the seed setting in sugarcane. There are the three types of crosses they generally attempt, intraspecific process and intergeneric process. This is the field view of a crossing plot at Kannur Center. And in the intraspecific process, we concentrate more on improving the species itself within the species by combining the different traits, whether it is a biotesters or yield or quality traits. And we have also a lot of improved officinarium population as well as improved robustum population. And in intraspecific, one of the crosses, Saccharum officinarum into spontaneum, is mainly done. Right, starting from 1987, the first attempt was done by Salt Beetle, followed by later in resulted in the development of VHL series clones in 1993, by Cobus in 1902 to 1909, that resulted in development of the VHL 2878 and VHL 2725. And in India, we have Venkatraman and Barber, the first commercial hybrid developed by an interspecific process between Saccharum officinarum, the valley, into Coimbatore cane, the Saccharum spontaneum. It is resulted in the development of CO205. And here, the normal genetic chromosome transmission is reported to be 2N type of transmission. The other interspecific process, Saccharum officinarum into Saccharum robustum, which is first reported by Nishiyama in Japan. And that resulted in the development of a lot of aneuploids, 2N69, 70, 80, and 81. And normal N plus N transmission was also reported, so as the 2N plus N model transmission. And another interspecific process, Saccharum officinarum into Saccharum sinensis. Here, when Saccharum officinarum is used as a female parent, where the transmission was 2N plus N and N plus 1. But when Saccharum sinensis into Saccharum officinarum was used, it was the transmission mode is N plus 2N. And among the intergeneric process, the intergeneric process has the history of sugarcane breeding itself. Starting from 1913, the first cross attempt was sugarcane breeding to Narenga. The major characters we are looking for from the Narenga was this earliness, tillering, erective habit, red rot resistance, mud resistance, mosaic resistance, and of course water logging also. And in later 1948, sugarcane into Miscanthus cross was mainly for the profuse tillering habit of Miscanthus, and so as the cold tolerance from Miscanthus. And Rumke in 1934, sugarcane into Arianthus, mainly for high fiber content and red rot resistance. And intergeneric crosses between Saccharum and Sorghum was attempted first in 1930 to introduce shoot fly resistance. And Saccharum Imperator crosses and Saccharum into Sia cross was done by Janagyamal in 1935 and 38. And the widest cross probably with respect to the morphological trace may be Saccharum into Bambusa. It was attempted in 1937. And seeing all these resources what we available and the well characterized and maintained germ plasm we have, we know that what are the characters which we available, the traits what are available with us. Now the major challenges still lying ahead is the narrow genetic base in the cultivated varieties. If you trace back our genetic recently released variety also to their pedigree, you'll find that it will either end up in chinny or black cherry bone or other handful of some Saccharum officinarum clones. That indicate that still the genetic base of the sugarcane is very narrow. We need to enhance it further by utilizing more and more widely varied genotype in the crossing program, including different species and related genera. And the second major challenge is abiotic stresses due to climate change. We know that climatic conditions keep on changing, and we need to develop climate resilient varieties, and we have to look for these diverse genetic resources for incorporating such traits. And the third aspect is again cost of cultivation. We are living in the era of doubling farmers' income. We know that we need mechanization is the key to reduce the cost of cultivation, and for mechanization we need to have a correct suitable ideotype for the ideotype for cultivation, and for that also we have to look into the correct ideotype in the genetic resources for incorporating that traits. And of course deterioration of the variety is another challenge. We need to replace the varieties very often, and this is a pest. Along with the climate change, new pests and diseases are keep on emerging, and these are the major challenges lying ahead of us. What we can do with the available genetic resources with us, what we can do further with the genetic resources in utilization, we'll see. And how effectively we can utilize the genetic resources for the developing new varieties with wide genetic base. We have to target on the integration using marker assisted or genomic assisted breeding, the faster breeding track. And of course, core and mini core set has to be developed for different set of clones. Now it is available for the Saccharum officinarum and Spontaneum on the core set, but again we have to go for the mini core set as well in other sections of other species clones and other sections of the genetic resources. And we should have focused identification of genetic resources, germplasm, not only with geographical gaps or exploration gaps, but we are looking for the some of the traits which there is a gaps in the traits. Some traits may not be available. We have to specifically look into that specific traits and go for exploration and find out material for the improving that specific traits. And strategy as a pre-breeding should be of the it should be practiced, and the pre-breeding still is going on, and we should have a lot of programs for improving the species we are in intraspecific improvement, Saccharum officinarum as well as Saccharum robustum, and also the wide hybridization for improving the enhancing the germplasm itself as a pre-breeding method, and for further utilization of the same with the specific traits into the breeding program. And gene prospecting and allele mining are essentially required to identify the specific traits from the genetic resources and the utilization of such genetic resources in the breeding program for improving the yield and quality and other parameters of the sugarcane crop. With this, I thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to interact with you people. And if you have some queries, I'll be able to attend. But I have some reservation of hearing from your side. I don't know, some problem is with audio. Still, we'll discuss some of the things. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah, thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. On behalf of all the participants and on behalf of the organizing committee, we'd like to thank you and extend our gratitude for such a lovely presentation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, if there are any questions, please ask. There are a few questions in the chat section. No, there aren't any food initiative making a database. No, sir, there are no questions. Can if there are any questions, please ask right now. Hello? Participants,
Hello.
do you have any questions, please? Sir, by which site database can be accessed?
It is not available on site. However, it is available with the Shokian Bidding Institute, a library. We can access from the Shokian Institute libraries.
Any other question by any other participant? No, sir, I don't think there are any further questions. On behalf of our organizing committee, participants, as well as NADCL, thank you very much for joining us. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. It was such a wonderful presentation. Thank you, sir.